ballast water management systems is a compliance method coming from environmental regulations. However, when we are talking about installation on board the vessels, there are safety aspects that we need to consider. These are related with the risks associated with the chemicals or byproducts produced by the systems. Risk associated when we have to install the system on a hazardous location, for example, within a pump room of an oil tanker, and some other design, let's say, risk that we're going to discuss. So most of the systems use two, let's say, categories of treatment. Physical separation, normally they have a filter, and disinfection, like chemical or physical disinfection, electrochlorination, UV, ozone, etc. And there are some systems that they have some additional disinfection method, supplementary, let's say, like cavitation. For inner gas deoxygenation system, now let's see what are the risks produced by, let's say, the most popular technologies. Looking into the inner gas deoxygenation systems, the risk relates whether the ballast tanks will be subject to excessive pressure, or there will be gases coming back to accommodation spaces or working spaces. So in that respect, within class rules, there are some safeguards like PV valves, breakers, PV breakers, etc., and some devices to avoid, to prevent gases returning back to the accommodation or to the living spaces. UV systems. For the UV system, normally we have a UV treatment during uptake together with a filter, and then during discharge of ballast water, we have another stage of UV treatment. The risk associated with to avoid the crew be exposed to excessive amount of UV light, and also the UV lamps will not run dry. So in that respect, we have some measures incorporated in our rules, like a high temperature alarm, UV intensity meters, and some interlocks that will prevent the UV lamps to run without water with them. For the prepared chemical treatment systems, normally in these technologies we have a filter after the ballast pump, and we have a tank with the chemicals, and we have a dosing pump which ejects the chemical into the ballast water pipe, and we have normally we have a venturi which mix the chemical with the ballast water. The risk associated with these technologies relate mainly with the handling and the use of chemicals, and aspects related with the crew, of course, but also with the vessel itself. So we ask, we normally ask a risk assessment to be carried out to ensure that the compartment where the chemicals stored has proper ventilation, fire protection, extinguishing systems, and also the personnel will not be exposed to the chemicals. For the ozone, ozone is very, let's say, dangerous, even in very small concentrations for the eyes and the respiratory system. So we have some safeguards in order to prevent the leakage of ozone. As you can see, this technology, normally we have an oxygen generator and then the ozone generator who converts the oxygen to ozone, and then the ozone is injected into the ballast piping. So safeguards relate with the shutdowns. When there is high concentration, you can see even very low concentration, 0.2 ppm, there will be a shutdown arrangement. For the electrochlorination systems, this technology actually uses direct current into the ballast flow, and by this method we have the development of the active substances, but also we have hydrogen generation as a byproduct. So our requirements relate mainly how we are we are going to deal with this issue of the hydrogen. So we have some arrangements, as you can see, interlocks with the ventilation systems, audible and visual alarms, and also fixed hydrogen gas detection systems. And also we have some safeguards to make sure that the ECU unit will not also run dry, because in the past we had some incidents on such type of technology. Now, looking on the materials of the systems, again, these have to comply with the class requirements. We prefer, of course, metallic materials, but there are some components and vendors that they are using non-metallic, and then we have some specific requirements for fire endurance test, depending also on the location that these materials will be fitted. And also, we want these non-metallic materials to be gathered in a skid, and we have some specific requirements about isolating this kit, and also about the compartment, the fire extinguishing, etc., where this kit is being located. There are also some design considerations regarding, for example, the damage stability. So we want to avoid the pipes of the ballast water management system to be located in the assumed extent of damage, or we need to have remotely operated valves if this is not possible. And also we have a specific requirements in case there is an emergency of the system to isolate some bypass arrangements. Now, let's look into the location, because it's very important where the system will be located. So if we have a typical bulk carrier or a container, we don't have hazardous location, but we need to have specific precautions for the compartment where the system will be installed in terms of the ventilation, especially if it is in a, let's say, electrochlorination system or an ozone system, as we mentioned earlier. And also we have concerns and specific requirements of fire protection, and these spaces are regarded as category A, and we have some specific requirements in that respect. Now, if we have to install a system and in a tanker, there are different ways to do it and different risks associated with this installation. So you can see here three possible, let's say, examples. We can have only the sampling unit installed in the non-hazardous location, and we have some specific requirements about the cabinet where the system, the sampling unit is being installed. The dosing unit also can be installed, and again, as you can see here, there in the sketch, we have some requirements for looping arrangement and non-return valves, and also the whole system can be installed, for example, in the engine room and to serve ballast tanks in a hazardous location. But there, again, we have some specific requirements of dab, block, and bleed arrangement, or loop, or spool piece, etc. So there are different options for the designers in order to prevent liquids or flammables from hazardous location coming back to the engine. And we have specific measures in our rules. Now, if we have to install, there is no other option, and we have to install the system in the pump room, again, there are specific requirements. Of course, the system needs to be X-proof, but also we have some specific requirements about the ventilation and interlocking with the pump room ventilation, and arrangement to ensure that there will be no spark due to the operation of the ballast water management system, and also during maintenance. There are cases where some components cannot be installed in a hazardous location, so there are also some options. For example, we can design a compartment as a non-hazardous, and this compartment can be installed at least 2.4 meters above the main deck of a hazardous area. And of course, we need to have some additional provisions that will not have ballast water piping getting into this pump room, or will not have flat connections, etc. If we do not have a compartment so high in the main deck, then we can have this arrangement, which is an airlock where we have two compartments with two gas-tight self-closing doors, and we have some specific requirements for overpressure in this area, and also audible and visual alarm, and specific requirements about the air changes in this area. So depending, because treatments, there are different technologies available in the market. Also, there are different designs on the vessel, and there is no, let's say, solution. There is no, let's say, solution fit to every system or to every vessel. So there are different ways to approach, but always we need to look into the safety aspects of the systems during installation. And this concludes my presentation. Thank you.